Welcome to Sunday Assembly Los Angeles.
Hey, everybody.
Yay! I'm Sarah.
And I'm Ryan, and we are the first-time hosts of Sunday Assembly Los Angeles, so thank you guys very much. We are a God-free community that celebrates a worldview grounded in evidence and reason.
We invite you to join us as we do our best to live better, help often, and wonder more.
Now, when we started, when Amy, the co-director, asked us to do this, that was the one thing that we had to do perfectly. Right? Yep. That's our mantra. We had to get the mantra out correctly. So now that that's done, Trump 2016, right, people? Yeah? All right. All right, this is a party. Good, great. All right. Well, so hey, all of you guys, first of all, thank you so much for being on time. Like, thanks. That's
great. Good job.
Great.
Good job, everybody.
Way Los to be Angeles. Here. Hey. So, yeah, there we go. So we're pretty packed right now. But this is what you could do me a favor. If there's spaces between yourself and the center aisle, we have this great usher crew, Noah right there. He wants to make sure everyone gets a place to sit. We're going to have people coming in late. So if you guys could move in towards the center, then when we have late people come in, we can just slip them in on the sides, and then you don't need like a butt flying in front of your face in the middle of the talk or something. So if everyone could just say, all right now, just scoot in and leave some room. Oh, and then we got front row seats, so who's brave? If anybody's brave, right here. All right, thanks guys.
We are really excited to welcome back Voices of Reason today. They are an a cappella group supported by Atheists United. They cater to agnostic, atheist, and humanist audiences, and you are in luck. They are actually looking for new members. You do not have to read music. You do have to carry a tune. But you can talk to them afterwards if you want to audition, or you can go to voicesofreason.net.
Okay, and now if everyone would please stand and join us for a song.
As you just heard, we are Voices of Reason, and we have a few songs to sing for you this morning. So everyone, ready to go? Please feel free to sing along.
Thank you.
All right, our program today is going to end right about noon, but that does not mean it's over. We always do coffee and snacks in the back where you can make new friends. And then we do lunch afterwards at the Oinkster right across the street. While you have got time afterwards, you can go in the back in the lobby. We have a lot of volunteer opportunities, some of which we are going to tell you about today if you want to get involved. So a couple of shout outs to those who brought clothing. I know Amy did. Where's Amy? Raise your hand. Amy and Ben. Where are they? They're somewhere. They brought buckets. There she is. She's like, don't call me out. Thank you to all of you who brought clothes. Those are going to Safe Harbor for youth. And then for anyone who brought food for our ongoing food drives. All right. Here's a couple of things that we have coming up. Some service opportunities. We have got the Garden Foundation, which is happening on Saturday, September 19th. This is a kid-friendly event. They do garden-based education, serving children all across Los Angeles. So if you like fun in the sun while helping people, this is definitely for you. We're also going to be serving a meal to the homeless on Monday, September 28th, and that is through a partnership with the Greater West Hollywood Coalition, Food Coalition. And then Let's Read is starting up again now that school is back in session on October 3rd. They do tutoring and reading to children. Ryan and I actually did it before we ever started coming to Sunday Assembly, and that was where we first met Jeff, who's right here. It's a really good time of interacting with the kids and reading them fun stories as they enhance their education.
Who was here last month for the Sunday Assembly line? We have some people that did that? Yeah? One? That's good.
There was
no,
more.
I'm sure we had a lot more. No, there was a lot more because during that time, they assembled 300 care packages for the homeless. And to do that, they raised $1,500 for that event. So that was amazing. Great job, everybody. So we want to give you a heads up. This is happening again. So we are preparing. So next month, we want to start collecting, we're doing travel-sized toiletries to put together for packages. And if you want to donate funds, you can do that on the website.
Now, if you heard all of these and you were like, I need to donate now, I have an opportunity for you. Cedars-Sinai Bloodmobile is here, if you didn't see it, and they are thirsty. They not only are you going to get warm fuzzies for donating and helping somebody, they are also going to give you a free ticket to the county fair. Just so happens that's going to be our next social event on the 20th, so you could go for free when you give the blood donation. We do want to stop and take a moment to acknowledge the fact that there are some archaic laws that we do not agree with that are currently preventing gay men and trans from donating. This is not something that we agree with and not something that we support, and we're hoping that it is going to change very, very soon. And we want all of you to know that we desire for our service projects to be inclusive of all. That's something that's very important to us. And we want you to know that you, everyone, is truly welcome in this community.
Milestones. Okay, mm-hmm. So we like to do milestones where you guys in the back, you submit to us some great things going on in your life so that we can share it for the rest of the community and we can share in what's going on with you. So, number one, Jason, it's his birthday today. Jason? Yeah! Happy birthday, man, happy birthday.
All right, we, sadly, this family had to say goodbye to one of their pets. It says Doyle was a great cat and family friend for 15 years, and we will miss him terribly. I might mess up your last name, but it doesn't change my sentiment towards you. The Revel Manfred family, we're sorry to hark about you. We love our dog.
We got another birthday. We got Daniel Williams, son of Kendall and Josh Williams. He's turned 16, sweet 16, on September 20th next week. So happy birthday for that coming
up. During our social. All right, and then last, David Beadle. David, where are you? Hi, David.
This is a big one.
So David won his first Emmy last night.
Yeah.
I'm going to read all the details so that he can savor in the moment. So, This was at the Technical Emmy Awards. He was part of a team of sound editors winning for Best Sound Editing for a miniseries on the History Channel's Houdini, starring Adrian Brody.
Wow. Congratulations. And then we would like to also take a moment to remember Nick Strickland. He was one of our own. He passed away recently. He was a much-loved board member and leader of the kids program in Sunday Assembly in San Diego. So our thoughts go out to his two children, his family's friends, and the entire San Diego Sunday Assembly community. All right. Oh, it's you.
It's me. Before we go to the rest of our program, we're actually going to dismiss our kids now. Anyone who wants to participate in Sunday Assembly Kids, it is free child care. There is a caregiver in the back who will meet any of the children that want to participate and their parents, and then we invite parents to come back so you can participate in the rest of the program.
All right, have fun.
In the lobby. Thank you, Amy.
Have a good time. Play safe. All right, so now it's time for the icebreaker. We do this. This is a fixture of this program. It's where you get a moment just to meet the people around you, find someone new, get connected with the people around you. If you are an introvert, this will be over really quickly. I'm sorry. just suck it up. It's really good for you. Okay.
Because you wanted to meet people.
Yeah. No. Okay. But for this one, it's going to be easier if we have a volunteer, and we have one in mind. It's going to be Ian.
Ian,
of course.
Will you come
Ian,
volunteer
come
with us?
Down here.
You're already standing. You make it easy.
This guy, he's always game. This is Ian. He's the co-director.
Yes.
Of Sunday Assembly. He's always a willing participant. So thank you.
Yeah. In this case.
Matter of perspective. All right. So this is what I need you to do. Just stand forward, please.
Right.
Face the audience, please. Great. Now just close your eyes. All right. Now you're going to take your arms and you're going to put them out in front of you, like point them out. Great. Have your palms face each other. Great. And just lower your arms, actually, just a little bit. Perfect. Now this is what you're going to do. You're going to slowly bring your hands together. Start bringing them slower, slowly. And then right when they touch, we're going to have you open your eyes. So right now.
Happy birthday to you.
Icebreaker. You probably figured that out. Okay, so our real icebreaker is going to require you to find a partner, and yes, it should be someone that you don't know, because that's the purpose of icebreakers. So between the two of you, you need to get a coin. It can be any coin. Just needs to have a year on it. I recognize that we're in a cashless society, so this
even
might
parking
be
meters.
Difficult.
Credit cards.
But then what you are going to do, and Ryan and I will demonstrate in all fairness, is you are going to have to say something that happened to you in the year that is on the coin. So to prove that we did not cheat and plan for this, I've asked Gina if she would have a coin ready for us. Gina, have I seen this coin before? Gina, do we know each other? Okay, so we have
a quarter here?
We have a quarter. Mm-hmm. Reading the year has not been my forte. Mm-hmm.
Where is it? It's the newfangled quarter.
Oh boy. So. Okay, we're going with 1788. No, 1999. Just kidding, 1999.
Okay.
So what were you doing in 1999?
All right, so 1999, the thing that sticks in my mind is like a killer 2000 millennial party.
Oh, yeah.
No, that was, I think we all had those. It was a big event. It was with all my high school friends.
Yeah.
And we just brought it in like it was 1999, like for real.
I definitely remember Y2K being the real thing.
Yeah.
Although I'm really into like apocalypse and zombie stuff, so I actually thought Y2K would be amazing, and I was incredibly disappointed when the whole thing just combusted.
All right.
Okay, so now it's your turn. So find someone you don't know.
Yes.
Because that's the whole point. If you don't have a coin, feel free to use the date that we just used, 1999. All right, everybody, simmer down.
Come back to us.
Bring it back. Wrap it up. Please say hi to them again at the end over some coffee or something. I really hope this worked out. I really hope like you found someone here that you can really bond with. Maybe a lifelong friend. I hope so. All right. Hey, did anybody get a coin the day was before they were born? Did that happen to anybody?
Yeah?
Come on. Did you really? Oh, nice. That's funny. I didn't know what you were going to do. Oh, okay, good. You solved it. Wonderful.
Very resourceful.
Good. All right, so right now it's time for our short performance. Usually we do a reading or we do an original poem of some sort, but we're going to mix it up today. A little bit different. We have Hannah and Anthony will be joining us as a musical guest. We're very excited. What's an interesting fact about them is they were the musical guests for like one of the very first assemblies, I believe, right? Yeah, very early on. That's what the card says. Yeah. So we're so excited to have you back. We're very excited to hear that song. Looks like you guys have a thing going. So give it up for Hannah and Anthony.
Great. Hello.
So, looking for me. I love this group sing thing, and I love the first song. That was so wonderful, hearing everybody's beautiful voices, and so the choir's going to help out with this one, and I need your help, too. I don't know if you guys have heard this song. It's called Ho Hey by the Lumineers, but will you guys help me with the ho and the hey? Can you do that? Yeah? Okay. They're going to show you what to do, and I'm going to try to remember to count you in. All right, so we'll practice a little bit here. So can we go, ho!
Ho!
Hey!
Hey!
All right, I think you guys are ready.
Ha!
Two, three, four.
Ho! Hey!
Excellent.
Ho!
Trying to do it right.
Hey.
I've been living a lonely life.
Whoa.
I've been sleeping here instead.
Hey.
I've been sleeping in my bed.
Whoa.
Sleeping in my bed.
Hey.
So show me family.
Whoa.
All the blood that I would bleed.
Hey.
I don't know where I went wrong. I don't know where I belong, but I can write a song. Two, three, I belong with you.
You belong with me in my sweet heart. I belong with you. You belong with me in my sweet heart.
Hey!
My children.
Not me.
I don't think you're right for him.
Hey.
Think of what it might have been if you took a bus to Chinatown and you're standing on canal in Bowery.
Hey.
You should be standing next to me.
Hey.
I belong with you. You belong with me in my sweet heart. And you belong with me in my sweetheart. And love we need it now. Let's hope, hope for some. 'Cause oh, we're bleeding now. But I belong with you, and you belong with me in my sweetheart. Yeah, I belong with you. You belong with me and my sweetheart.
Hey.
Ho!
Last one.
Last one.
Hey!
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you, thank you very much.
Hannah and Anthony, choir and family, it is my honor to introduce you next to our speaker, Jean Franzblau. Jean is both a speaker and a sex-positive educator. She teaches workshops on women's empowerment, on, I knew I was going to forget the next word, sexual esteem, and she has 18 years experience with a 12-step recovery program. She's here today to talk to us about the power of touch. Please welcome Jean.
Wow. Beautiful music. Am I on? Am I official? Can you hear me?
The phrase touch deprivation is a good one because it assumes that touch is a need and that without it, that there are consequences. And I'm here to tell you that it is a need and that there are consequences. There are studies and research that reveals that touch deprivation impacts your level of stress. It also has effect on your capacity to sleep deeply. It impacts your immune system and also your cardiovascular health. A baby who
isn't touched in their baby years, their baby months. That means that their growth hormone is not stimulated for their growth, and so without touch, an infant cannot grow into a healthy kid. And so even with all of these facts, absolute scientific facts, the issue is, it's a silent problem, a silent issue. Many of us are touch deprived. And I say us, because the US Bureau of Labor Statistics tells us that over half of the people in the United States are single. That is a lot of people who have limited access to touch in their lives. And even people who are partnered up, and in marriages deal with touch deprivation. Perhaps you've heard of the concept, or even felt it, of an affectionless marriage. So happily, we have friends, right? And so it could be, perhaps it's a happy ending, because we have friends. Yet there was a study about how friends interact, like for example, in a cafe. And it was a study by Sidney Girard. So what he did is he watched people talking in cafes across the world. So he went to various locations and counted how many times that the individuals touched over the course of 60 minutes. What would you guess the answer is for England? And for the US, we can be proud that in moments and bursts of enthusiasm, our number is 2. Be proud. What do you think that it is for France? Please call it out. 5? Maybe it's 15. And this number really surprised me right here. Some people's needs for touch are taken care of without any effort. Perhaps they have a loving spouse who they get to snuggle with at night, or partner or lover. Perhaps they have children who need and give lots of hugs. Or maybe they live in Puerto Rico. But this isn't the case for everyone. In fact, there's a fellow who calls himself Juan. And he was very depressed. He had had a breakup. And he dragged himself to a party one night. And somebody he didn't know, somebody who was a stranger to him, gave him a hug. And I'm going to paraphrase what he said. He said it was the best thing that ever happened to him. He said he felt like a king. And he was so inspired by that one touch that he did something really unusual. And rather than explain it to you, I'd like to show you. Thank you.
It's from a band. Like this video. Can you hear me okay now? All right. And I think that there's so many people come back to it again and again is because the touch-starved come in every size and shape and gender and socioeconomic level. The touch-starved live in studio apartments and mansions alike. But that's why it's so great and inspiring when people come together, like here at Sunday Assembly. So moving to hear your laughter and your applause just now. And yet, even when people are in close proximity, there can still be a divide. It's a silent problem. Like, it's not super accepted to talk about it. Like, you're at the copy machine at work, and somebody says, how you doing? And you say, I could use a snuggle. It doesn't often happen. And then HR is involved. Touch is taboo at work. I should know, as I took a part-time job working in cubicle environment, I'm like, I'm starving here. And forget about it in our culture if you're a man. Men's needs are vilified. Men's needs for touch are vilified as wanting only one thing. My name is Jean Franzblau, and one of the things that I do is cuddle, professionally. You might wonder how I came upon this unusual profession, and I'll tell you. For a good part of my early adult life, I was single, and I became extremely independent, which is wonderful. But there were also piercing moments of loneliness that I experienced. I remember one time I had a business trip to Honolulu, which seemed really glamorous, but inwardly I felt very lost. So much so that I found somebody. He was a military man who was on leave, and I took him hostage. I didn't realize it at the time, but in hindsight, that's what I was doing. I invited myself to join him for dinner. We had nothing to talk about at dinner. In fact, I was ignoring the fact that he was rude. I couldn't hear it, but I'll repeat it to you now. He made a comment that he figured I must have Jewish heritage because of the size of my nose. And so I ignored that because I had a goal, and I was going to meet my goal. And after a long time, I finally lured him up to my hotel room. And I had sex with him. And then finally, this was my moment. I said, let's spoon. And he said, I won't do that. And I'm like, what? Like, excuse me? I've devoted 5.5 hours to this enterprise. I was incredulous. I was humiliated. He said, that's something that I would do with a girlfriend. I've got to go. And that's when I realized that I had some major needs for human touch that were not being fed, and that I had a belief that there was only one way for me to get it. And I'd like to give you my news. What I learned is that I was absolutely wrong. I had heard about these events. They were called cuddle get-togethers. And I became fascinated with them. And I kept Googling Los Angeles and cuddle, trying to find one. And then when finally I found my first one and attended, I was absolutely hooked. And then I began having events for myself called Cuddle Sanctuary. These are social events, and they're also workshops where no touch is required, but it's a place where touch is welcome and invited. And one of the things that we learn together is how to receive a no thank you with grace. So we receive rejection with grace. And we learn how to say no thank you if we're not wanting any kind of touch. And this has been a revolution for me and for many people who have attended.
Now, some people here in the room have attended cuddle events of some sort, and you do not have to out yourself, of course. However, if you feel comfortable sharing, if you've ever attended an event like this, if you feel comfortable with that, would you please raise your hand so we can see who you are? All right, so it's not so uncommon. So what I'd love to do is give you an experience of what it's like at Cuddle Sanctuary. This is a non-touch experiment that we're about to have. I'm going to invite you, if you do not feel like doing this experiment, to just don't. In fact, I would say that observation and witnessing is participating. Are you agreeable to that? Okay. So here's what is going to happen. You're going to find somebody just right near you, behind you, in front of you, across the aisle. One is person number one. One person will say, may I practice this with you? May I give you a hug? And Brett will say, and I answer, thank you for taking care of yourself. And if you'll notice, there's an explanation point. I say it with cheerfulness. I say it with gladness. Because there is nothing like receiving a hug from somebody who doesn't want to give it. Have you ever experienced that? Very unpleasant. Isn't it unpleasant when somebody gives you a hug and you weren't expecting it and you didn't want it? Right? So we ask for it. So please do that experiment right now. But before you begin, I got this beautiful artifact from Australia and I want to share it with you. The only reason I have that is because we're such a big group and this causes such interesting conversation that the whole thing, this whole talk might end right here. So you will hear that and you will know it's time to wrap up your conversation so we can finish. I have so many great things to share with you after this exercise begins. Is that at least 20 seconds of touch, so sustained touch, gets the oxytocin running in your body. Oxytocin is a peptide hormone that only exists in mammals, and some people call it the hug hormone, the cuddle chemical, because it gets ignited when a mother breastfeeds a child. It gets ignited when people share that loving touch for about 20 seconds or so. And I would like to give you an experience of what this is like. So, once again, you have an option to opt out. The only people who will officially be participating are the ones who are feeling emboldened to ask somebody else to participate with them. So, you know, would you like to do this exercise with me? And some of you are going to say no, thank you, because you just don't. So remember, those of you who are doing the asking, to say thank you for taking care of yourself and then move on, okay? So once you find that partner, which ideally will take, oh, about, you know, 20, 30 seconds, this is where, so that was like, that's sort of intermediate work, even asking. What comes next is sort of intermediate advanced, which is you're going to negotiate something. Maybe you will negotiate something non-touch, which would be eye gazing or a staring contest, just looking into each other's eyes. Look for the color of the person's eyes. And that's the whole experiment. Or perhaps you'll choose a handshake or a high five or a fist bump. All of those are great, and yet they might not ignite your oxytocin. So you could also choose to have a hug. Short hug is great. It won't ignite your oxytocin. So the two things, this is advanced work if you choose to do this, the two things that will would be a hug for at least 20 seconds, just hanging out there, breathing, feeling the person. Now please keep this in mind, and I need you to raise your hand that you can comply with this. At any moment, thanks for complying before I even said it. Thank you. You're awesome. So at any moment you can change your mind. You can say to a person, yes, I'd like to do this exercise with you. No, I just changed my mind. You can say, yes, I'll have a hug with you. I've just changed my mind. Or you can say, I'll do a long hug. You know what? I need a short hug. Thank you. And the other party will say, okay. So you're welcome to do this with somebody that you know. You're welcome to simply watch what happens around you. That's participating. And you're welcome to do this with somebody you don't yet know. You get to choose the experience you want to have. This is going to take just a few, like a minute or two. And then you know the sound that you will hear, that you will really hear it, and you will really have a seat so we can continue on. Okay, go. Begin. Stand and do. This talk and beyond, if you're sitting next to somebody that you feel comfortable holding hands with their consent, please feel free to do so. Please feel free. So this is a powerful experience, and not everybody had a terrific time. I want to acknowledge that. Some of you might be like, wow, that was awesome, and others of you are like, and now I feel horrible. For a variety of reasons. Maybe it's because you chose not to and you're like, wow, I missed something great. Or maybe you chose to and you said, wow, I said yes when I meant no. Thank you very much for acknowledging that for those who were like, This is one of the most challenging things in our group, and people, especially the first time they come to Cuddle Sanctuary, they say, wow, I don't know how to say no, thank you. This is hard. And they go, I'm coming back. So it seems like it's a workshop and a social experience, and it's just like a Saturday night thing or a Wednesday night thing that you just do. But some people come back because it is a practice, and it's a communication practice that informs other areas of their lives. One guy said he attended, he goes, you know, I just told my boss no thank you to an assignment recently. I'm like, and I've heard some incredibly empowering stories from people who have attended. And we've got a lot of frequent flyers as well. So I appreciate your courage in participating in any way that you did. And my big passion here is that we begin to consider that touch becomes a priority in our lives. And I'll just say it for myself. I've become to make it a practice, a health practice. Before we get more into health, I want to talk to you about let me tell you about Edmund Rolls. He's a neuroscientist. He says that touch activates the brain's orbitofrontal cortex, which is linked to feelings of reward and compassion. And perhaps just by putting your head on somebody's shoulder or holding hands as you might be right now, or that hug that you got, you might feel that sense of reward right now, like you got something yummy, or that feeling of compassion that the heart opens a bit. But for adults, the benefits of touch might surprise you. There was a study published by the journal Emotion that found that when NBA basketball players, the ones that touch more often, win more games. And then we get back to the physiological benefits of better sleep. After Cuddle Sanctuary, I have a deeper sleep that I remember happening more when I was a child, that changed when I was an adult. It's just a more satisfying sleep. And I wake up with a feeling of wellness, sort of, it's hard for me to explain. It's like all is well in my world, like I feel okay. It's sort of being a part of the human community in a way that I never really had words for, and I didn't know I was longing for, but I was. But back to the physiological things, yes, it impacts your cardiovascular health and wellness. It makes your immune system, it boosts the immune system. Do you hear the good news in all of us? There are many people here who are very health-oriented. Can you raise your hand if you pay attention to what you eat, or if you exercise regularly? And then there are other folks who've raised your hands who are like, you know what, I know I should, but I don't really. I have such great news for you, because for all of us, for everybody in this room, you could choose to have more touch regularly in your life. You can make it that priority as an arsenal for your good health. You can improve your health by doing something fun, by doing something enjoyable, by feeling more connected to people in your community. This is fabulous news. And so, how can you get more touch in your life? And the answer is, calendar it. Imagine what life would be like if on Monday you could look forward to exchanging a foot rub with a friend. And on Tuesday, you would know that you could have a hug. You've scheduled that hug during your lunch hour. And there's a new app that just re-came out. It was called Cuddler, C-U-D-D-L-R, and now it's basically, if you Google it, you'll find it, where you can find people who are looking for a cuddle nearby. It's new, so it's not perfect, but try it out. The more of us who do it, the more we'll be able to find each other. And what if on Wednesday night you can come to a cuddle, and then on Thursday you can have movie night with a friend, and you get my point that every day it's in there. And to help you, I'm here to help people. So to help you, I'd like you to know that if you enter the code S-A-L-A, do you guys say Sala? You can get $5 off, and we're going to have our very first free hugs event, just like it showed in that video, on 3rd Street Promenade on September 20th. We're meeting in front of the Chipotle at 5 p.m. So touch deprivation. I'm ready to let that go, to make that something that's part of my past. And I feel like we all have that opportunity to make a conscious choice to say no to that, and yes, to more healthy human touch. Thank you. I have very cute flyers, but they're not on the snack table, they're on the community table.
As we're getting loaded up here on the stage, I wanted to say thank you, Sunday Assembly, for having us. Thank you, Jean, for that fantastic talk. That was so cool. I'm a very touchy-feely person myself, so I'm like, oh good, now I can feel like I'm giving back to the community by doing that. And one of the things about this next song we're about to sing for you, you will be familiar with the theme, and I think it's kind of cool you can think about how this need for touch might have come about. In this song, Charles Darwin brought forth the most profound discovery about life in his book called The Origin of the Species. Now, this book didn't have any talking snakes in it, and there weren't any animals getting on an ark in pairs, but still, it was a pretty good book, so let us praise him.
That was fun. That was a lot of fun. Thanks, guys. Thank you so much. All right. Right now, we're doing a little bit we call Assemblers Doing Their Best. Every month, we like to get a member of the community to come forward and share what's going on in their lives. So this month, I'm pleased to introduce Leonard Cachola right here, and he was going to do today's assemblers doing their best. Thanks, Liz.
Really? Okay, the following is a 4-minute version of an unpublished 300-page memoir. Church was never a part of my life growing up, though I did wonder if there was a God or not. Although both of my parents were Catholic, they rarely took me to church. Instead, Dad took me to play tennis on Sundays while Mom worked. After I gave up tennis in high school, I chose to spend my days making art, watching movies, reading books, playing video games, and spending time with friends. But something was missing. It was Valentine's Day 10 years ago when I went to the restroom, reached down, and discovered something very wrong with my body. I had just gotten home from a date with a woman I was seeing, and wondered if it was something that I had done, or she and I had done, or in our case, hadn't done. On March 10th, after surgically removing a malignant tumor, the doctors told me I had cancer. I would like to say I was brave, but truth be told, my youthful invincibility had mentally given way to the harsh reality of the Big C. Not once did I pray to a higher power for intervention on my behalf, though a coworker did take it upon himself to introduce me to the Episcopal Church. While I was trying to figure out what to do with this second chance of life, the woman I was dating decided to continue her life without me. 3 months after my surgery, my father died of a sudden illness. Although religion wasn't a part of my life, a strong desire to see my father again in heaven was enough for me to look into learning how to follow God's will. I spent 6 years wrapping my skeptical head around the spiritual teachings of Christianity and the Word of God while attending that same Episcopal church on and off. Although I never fully believed in the resurrection story, I made friends because they seemed nice enough, even if they were high on that Jesus guy. My time at that church came into an abrupt end after dating a Mormon, whom I wanted to be with more than anyone else at the time, thanks to her charm, wit, and intelligence. Unfortunately for me, she only wanted to marry a Mormon, or fortunately. To her credit, she never asked me to convert to Mormonism. While we were dating, I took it upon myself to read the Bible, the Book of Mormon, Dan Barker's Losing Faith in Faith, chatted with young adults from Generation Atheist, and decided I didn't believe in this God stuff after all. Since there was no point in continuing to waste time and energy trying to follow a supreme being whose will I could never discern, an existence I didn't believe in, I left Christianity and my Episcopal friends behind. When I told the Mormon I wouldn't convert to something I didn't believe in, she shut me out of her life. I understood why she did it, but that didn't make the split any easier. With a strong desire to start over in a community that valued knowledge, experience, and a healthy dose of questioning, I sought out the company of other godless folk, optimistic I could make myself better, faster, stronger. Well, 1 out of 3 ain't bad. It was the best decision I ever made. Sharing journeys into godlessness with the young adults of Generation Atheist taught me I was not alone in a reality free from imagined deities. The humanism I found under the umbrella of Unitarian Universalism taught me how to appreciate a diverse range of beliefs, respect for all life, and learn the importance of serving others. And finally, Sunday Assembly has given me a community free from God, even if it's all right if you aren't. 10 years into this second life and 2 years since my last surveillance test revealed I had defeated cancer in a rout, I look out at this sea of both familiar and unfamiliar faces and can say this long winding journey has been worth it because of the friendships I have made and for the friends I have yet to meet. I look forward to seeing what twists and turns the next 10 years will bring.
Good morning. It's very nice to see all of you. Would you mind lowering the lights a little bit for me back here in the back? Thank you. So my name is Sarah Barker, and this is the time when we take just a few moments to be silent and just kind of be present with ourselves. I'm a meditation practitioner, and I have been for about 15 years now, and I find meditation to be transformative. Because Jean kind of inspired me with her topic of cuddling, I thought we would work on a little bit of emotional intimacy today. We're going to work with what's called a metta meditation. That's loving kindness meditation. So if everybody could just sit up straight but relaxed with a nice erect back, make sure that you have both feet on the floor. And you want to sit at the edge of your chair so that you're alert, but you're also relaxed. So once you've done that, and if you desire, you don't have to, feel free to close your eyes. And what we're going to do now is we're going to start with paying attention to our breath. When you're new to meditation, sometimes it helps to have something to focus on. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ring this gong that I brought with me, and I ask that you pay attention to the sound of the gong, and you follow the sound of the gong until you can no longer hear its resonant tone. Here we go. So what we're going to do now is, now that your eyes are closed, take a nice deep breath and draw your attention to your breath. There's a couple places where we can find breath. It could be from your nose, the air, the feeling of the air moving in through your nostrils and out through your nostrils. Or you can draw your attention to your belly and feel your diaphragm expand as you breathe in and contract as you breathe out. And your mind will probably wander to this or that, but I ask that if your mind wanders to noise in the room, to a thought that arises in your mind, simply return your attention back to your breath. Now, when you feel ready, I want you to recall the face of someone that you love. Focus your attention on an image of that face as if it were a photograph. Bring that image into your mind. Again, your mind may wander to noises in the room, to what you plan on doing after Sunday assembly. Simply bring your attention back to your breath and to the image of this face. Continue to breathe naturally. If you feel any tension in your body, just relax that tension. Relax your shoulders. And keep your mind focused on the image of that face. And now I'm going to read off a couple of simple thoughts. And as you hear them, I want you to repeat them in your mind as you continue to see this face in your mind. May you be happy. May you be happy. If your mind starts to wander, simply bring your attention back to your breath. Now, just relax your body, take a deep breath, and when you're ready, open your eyes. Sorry, I think that was meant to be a longer meditation. Thank you so much, and have a great day.
We have another milestone fresh off the presses. Joe would like to wish Pedro happy 24 years of being married.
Congratulations.
Congrats, guys. Yeah.
Don't.
Seriously, so I came in today and said
Okay, yeah, don't get them confused, guys. That could be an awkward ride home.
All right, now is the time when you have an opportunity to give back to Sunday Assembly through our collections. We are entirely donor-supported, so every month when we have this event, it is as a direct result of the donations we receive. We also are expanding and potentially thinking about other locations, and donations allow us to do things like that. So we've got our wonderful ushers of Normally. Ryan is one of them. Shout out. They're going to be passing boxes through for any of you who prefer the plastic variety. We do have card readers. We've got our card readers raising hands, so just hold that up and they will come see you. Additionally, you can always donate online if that's easier for you or back at the merch table. You might have noticed that some of our members have very special name tags that are green. That is because they are sustaining members, which means they have a regular donation that happens each month. So thank you guys so much. Ryan and I just recently became sustaining members, so we could tell you without guilt that we are sustaining members.
I did it, guys.
There it is.
It took a year. It took a year, but
that's embarrassing.
But we made it, though, so that's all that counts.
So if you've been here before, you've probably seen that I'm usually one of these guys in the passing the plate. A fun fact, I grew up in the church. I was in the church for, 20-something years. When I was a young kid, a job that they had me do at the church was passing the offering plate. So I did that for many, many years when I was younger. And so now I come here, I'm just really happy that the one thing that I took from my church life is the ability to efficiently collect money from strangers. So... I'm really glad I could bring that here. So that was really good.
I also grew up in the church, and that's part of where I met Ryan. If you guys hadn't figured out we're married,
yeah, we're married.
I feel like we probably should have said that. And we actually are going to be celebrating 10 years of being married next month.
Next month. 10 years. Thank you.
Now, I know what you're all thinking, because everyone asks us, is were you of legal age when you got married? And we were. And we still like each other, and I still think he's handsome. So I think we've decided that we're going to keep this thing rolling.
We're going to stay married. Try another 10.
It's still working. So a big part of our journey, as we've mentioned, was church, and that was really where we found all of our community. Our friends were in it, all of our family, and when we made a change and left about 5 years ago, it really had a big gap for us. And we found ourselves really missing having that group that we could share joys with and challenges, and it was through that journey that we found Sunday Assembly.
Yeah, we heard the NPR article, or the news report. I'm sure a lot of you heard it. When I was driving and I heard that, it clicked immediately, because Sarah was just talking about all these aspects of community that we just didn't have in our life anymore. So I heard that on the radio. I went home immediately and I said, we gotta give this a shot. So we came in. It was so much fun right away. I think we sang a Green Day song, which was
pretty
amazing.
It's so amazing.
And so right away we were hooked. We met so many great people. We kept coming. Then we decided to help out, and then we even met more people. And our relationships deepened, and it's fit our lives real well. It gave us what we were looking for, and what we want most of all is that this could be a place, if that works for you, this can be that place where you can find your community and find what you're looking for.
And we always like new friends, so you can come chat with us.
Yeah, you can talk to us. We're cool.
Okay. Well, we did it, guys. We did it. We're just going to...
We're on to the final announcements.
Wrap up. So we just got closing announcements here. So before we have the last song, this is what's going to happen. We have the next assembly is October 11th. Mark the calendar. And we are featuring radio personality and comic Ron Placone. Now, this is going to be interesting. Ron will talk about how increasingly consolidated for-profit media affects democracy, and then help us challenge the way that we, the people, interact with news and corporate media. So it's going to be a little political, a little interesting. So if you're RSVP on SundayAssemblyLA.org, and then also get that going on Facebook, get that social media buzzing.
As I mentioned before, we have our social event coming up on September 20th. We are going to be going to the county fair. And if you remember, blood donation equals warm fuzzies and a ticket, so you can go ahead and do that.
Yep.
What?
The fair.
That's the later thing. Oh, and I did want to say one more thing. If you do donate and you get a ticket and you aren't able to go, we would love if you would donate that to another Sunday Assembly family that might want one, so you could drop that off at the merch table.
All right, we got a bunch of other awesome things coming up. We have a Doctor Who movie night. So I've never seen an episode. I think I'll just catch up before I get there. Will that work? How many seasons? Like three? What is it? There's a comedy show coming up, brought to us by Gina. We have puzzle rooms, which are amazing, and lots more. So if you stop at the community table out in the lobby, you can get more information about that. And again, you can also check out the social and service sections at sundayassemblyla.org for more details.
We're going to invite Voices of Reason up for their last song.
So this will be our final number. As Sarah mentioned earlier, we are looking for new members. So whether you've been in a choir before, or if you've been in musical theater, or you just really rock it out in karaoke, come and talk to us afterwards. We meet roughly twice a month in Echo Park, so not that far from here, for about 2 hours each. We would love to talk with you afterwards, anyone who's interested in coming to join the group. So this has been my first time at Sunday Assembly, and it's great to see you all. I was so glad to hear the segue about community being important, because it is. We gather here at Sunday Assembly because we have a deep need for community and for connection, because let's face it, some things in life are bad. They can really make you sad. And other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, don't worry, give a whistle, and this'll help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps. Just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. For life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bow. Forget about your sin, give the audience a grin. Enjoy it, it's your last chance anyhow. And always look on the bright side of death. Just before you draw your terminal breath. Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show. Keep on laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the bright side of life. We can't really hear you. Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the bright side of life.
Thank you.
the back, and we'll have them till about 1 o'clock, 1:30, and then you can head over to the Oinkster for lunch.
Remember that the Bloodmobile is in the parking lot until 2 p.m. today, and you can register that for that in the lobby. And Sarah, may I give you a hug?
Yeah. Thank you. Until next time, we hope that you live better, help often, and wonder more. Thanks, everybody.